Hello, everyone, and welcome to Art 100, Looking at Art. I'm Bernard Baker, Professor of Art at California State University Dominguez Hills. And today we have a lot of exciting things happening. To begin with, we're going to be talking about two chapters, Chapter 10, Graphic Design, and Chapter 11, Sculpture. So I have lots of stuff around to play with, so we'll be doing some demos to kind of help you understand some of these issues. And I wanted to add that today, of course, is the opening for the midterm. I'll be doing that right after class. I'll go over to my office, and I will open up the midterm about 5 o'clock and have that open for you. And you have a week to deal with the midterm until next Tuesday. And it's an open book exam, open your notes, wherever you want to go to, you can use those resources and respond to the midterm. But we have to have it done by next Tuesday. And there are no repeats. You only get one shot at it, okay? Now, again, if anyone has any difficulties, have any problems, something crashes, let me know, email me, and I'll see if I can help you with anything goes wrong with the midterm in that sense. So make sure you keep in touch with me, okay? All right. So those are the two big things that are happening. And after that, of course, we're going to continue. Next week, we're going to have a guest, and we talk about architecture, so make sure you are here when we're getting with that, and we'll go forward. All right. The question I have for you today is concerning a piece of graphic design work. And the question is, this is by David Carson. And I ask, what is David Carson's premise regarding the reaction of the audience to his, quote, ray gun, unquote, magazine spread in an article on Morrissey? Okay, so you can see it on the screen there. The question I'm asking is not involved, but basically David Carson designed a magazine article spread for a musician named Morrissey and for the magazine Ray Gun. And he wrote something, and he said something about his premise regarding how the audience, that is us who read magazines and would see this ad, the spread rather, how we would react to it. And that's what I'm asking you to explain. Okay? So we'll look at that in a while, and see if we can get some feedback from you on that. You can call 1-800-339-1193, or, as most of you already do, you can text in your response, and I'll read it here, and we'll see what kind of reaction you have to that particular question. Okay, let's talk about graphic design. The definition from the text of graphic design is that graphic design has as its goal, and I add something here, visual communication of some visual of some specific message to a group of people. Okay? That's the definition that our text provides. It's a thing about the word visual, and I like to put the word visual communication in there because really graphic designers don't deal with communication in other forms, like they don't deal with communication of speaking. They don't deal with communication of music. They don't write music. They don't write a lot of text. Some do. Most graphic designers don't deal with text. They don't deal with the vocal communication like we hear on the radio. So basically they're dealing with visual communication, what we can see in the printed piece, whether it's on in a magazine, or whether it's on television, or whether it's on the internet, in digital form, books, whatever it might happen to be. That's what they deal with, okay? Now, I have a definition that I give my students, because I have taught a lot in graphic design, and that's my primary job area is graphic design. And I tell my students that graphic design is a visual solution to a marketing problem. You might want to remember this, but it might show up someplace.
a visual solution to a marketing problem. And the reason I use that definition is because really graphic design is a profession for business, primarily the business community or nonprofit community, that is some with a community where there is two parts. There is the client, the business, or the nonprofit organization, whatever it may be, and the people for whom the document or that these entities serve. I mean, if we stop and think about the normal process, a huge company would be producing a product or service, and they're selling that to a market. And graphic designers are brought in to help perpetuate that process of selling the product or the service. And if you think about that, it's true with virtually anything where there is the existence of those two sides. And even today, in our climate of the elections coming up next week, which I hope, by the way, if you're a voting age, you will vote, and all the information we hear on television, the ads we see, and the ads we hear on the radio, and the material we get in the mail, is all generated, well, the graphic stuff is generated by graphic designers, in part. And so their task is to make sure that the visual image composition is suitable for what the message is. So they're really providing a visual solution to a marketing problem. The problem is getting out the message visually. That's the problem. Elected official or a candidate will say, well, I want to get my message out to this audience in Southern California. And they will describe what they want and say, here's what we're trying to say, here's what we want to see, we want to show my family, and, you know, show me, hugging babies and shaking hands with people, whatever it is they want. And then the graphic designer takes that information, puts it into a visual composition, which is the solution, and then the process goes forward. So that's where I'm coming from with my definition. Okay, what's an important event about the occurrence and the development of graphic design? One is the invention of the printing press in 1436 by Johannes Gutenberg. Also, he dealt with movable type, which was an important advance in printing. And here we see an example, this visual, of typical Gutenberg printing press. And it's a press that really evolved from the great press, where there would be this flat, what's called a platen here, and on the bottom on the table is the image using a relief print, and we know what that is now. Paper would be laid on top of that, and then this platen would be forced down, and it would then print the image. So it's very literally like a mechanical rubber stamp, where we bring, except we have it upside down, we bring the stamp down onto the paper, and wham, we have an image. Movable type actually evolved, was developed, in the Orient, Chinese. Here we see some examples of Chinese movable type, where they put their characters on separate blocks. Now, wasn't that innovative? Because before, they had all these on one big plate with the characters put together. They would carve these all out individually for one particular statement. And it's very laborious, and it can only be used for that one particular statement. But this, we can combine these all different ways. So we can, you know, go any kind of way here to make whatever words we want. So that's a tremendous advantage. And Gutenberg brought onto that. He brought that into the printing process in the 1400s, and there you have the printing press. It's tremendously advantage because it made available inexpensive process of disseminating printed information. Of course, the Bible was one of the first things that were printed. And next, it brought the Bible to the people. And newspapers and leaflets and pamphlets began to emerge because they could be done very quickly and very inexpensively. So those are two important things. So our Gutenberg Press and movable type in 1436. And then the second major event that happened was the Industrial Revolution in the 18th and 19th centuries. And of course, this brought about mass production, which again brought products and services to the mass populace. Along with that came the need to advertise and to let the market know that these products and services were available. So here you see one of those gigantic machines from the Industrial Revolution, big beams and big chains that would drive all these mechanisms and spit out some kind of product or service. And people here working away. And this was a process of mass production, of innovation, a tremendous amount of discoveries were done in that time, and it just brought about the era that we now have, and it continues in a way. I mean, the Industrial Revolution is still going, because new things are being brought about, new materials, new processes, it's still going on. But when it started in the 1800s started, basically in Europe and England specifically, it just revolutionized commerce, revolutionized business, and of course from that came the need for graphic design, and more of that profession began to evolve. So those are two important events that took place. The invention of the printing press by Johannes Gutenberg, together with movable type. He didn't invent it, but he used it. And second, the Industrial Revolution. So you want to remember those. Now, I want to take you to a couple of slides just to see kind of what graphic designers do. And I have up here, I want to go to a graphic design site. This is a graphic designer, I forgot his first name, but his last name is Bright, and it's called Bright Design. And these are some of the pieces that he's designed. He designed the National Car Rental. Here's a brewing company, the Kern Brewing Company. They designed the can design. Net Zero, which is a internet provider, if I remember correct. Terra Chips, he designed the labeling and packaging for Terra Chips. Let's see what else we can find here in the portfolio. We'll see some of the other pieces that he's done. Pretzel Chips. Graphic designers do a lot of packaging design. They do logos. Here's a logo for, I think it's a non-profit organization with my own two hands. And notice how they use hand prints here for this as flower images. Kind of a unique way to show children's involvement. We've already seen the National Car Rental, Terra Chips, Net Zero, UCLA Athletics. They designed graphics for the UCLA Athletics. The 84 Olympics, they did the signage basically what's called traffic signage, which is showing people where to go and identifying certain location of events. They did that for the Olympics. That's a real kudos for a graphic design company to get to design that. It's a very major kind of the event that they dealt with. Here's some more. Accelerator, I'm not sure what that is. Probably some company. It's like a logo they've done. Alexia Foods, they must have done some packaging for them. They don't show what they've done here. I don't think they designed the food. Allergan, looks like they designed the logo there. Aviva Center, they might have done some. I'm not sure what they've done here, if they did the graphics or the logo for them. HelloFresh, looks like they did they did packaging for them. You can see these are those little packages for like sour cream and that kind of thing that we just take for granted. Someone designs those. So graphic designers really get involved in this kind of process of really putting a visual of on objects that we just take for granted. Your chewing gum, the package your shoes come in. The labeling on garment, you go to buy a garment, the price label, maybe the label of what the garment is, all of those kinds of things are designed by graphic designers. And so that's one area. The graphic design studio really deal with a lot of those kinds of projects. As opposed to advertising, although they get into advertising, but advertising really goes to another arena. It's called the advertising agency. So I pick one up here. Let's see if I can find it. Saatchi & Saatchi. They're headquartered over in Torrance, not too far from us here. And these are some of the pieces that they've done. Miller High Life, they've done some advertising for Miller High Life. Hudson & Hudson, I think their shirts. They did advertising for them. Cheerios Love, they did that campaign of Cheerios Love. Which one is this? This is David and Glenn Make Homosexuals Marry. I'm not really sure if that was a movie graphics or what they did on that one. JCPenney Doghouse Fun, Fiber One. I've seen this on television. They did a television commercial. Whoops. So these are all, you know, advertising agencies deal with major advertising for the most part. There are smaller advertising agencies that may not get into television campaigns, internet campaigns, national or even worldwide campaigns. This is a big agency. Saatchi & Saatchi is a big worldwide agency. They have offices all over the world. J. Walter Thompson is another big agency worldwide. In fact, J. Walter Thompson is credited for being the first advertising agency to emerge out of the Industrial Revolution. They originated in New York. And they kind of caught on to the need of businesses to have this major advertising campaign. So advertising in that sense is really more dealing with a campaign of advertising. A lot of election campaign candidates hire advertising agencies to design a campaign. They'll do print media, they'll do radio, they'll do television, maybe internet, iPod, or what, you know, the way BlackBerry, they'll do all of these formats as a campaign. So there's a theme that runs across all of those different media. And the graphic designers involved in that from the visual standpoint, they'll bring in sound people, they'll bring in music people, they'll bring in copywriters, photographers. A huge team will be brought together to build this campaign. It's very exciting. It has the kind of involvement where people will have a project and they'll work, you know, maybe 100 hours a week. They'll work right into the night, many times all night to get to meet deadlines, and then that project will be done and over with, and they may have a slump for a month or so and have very few jobs, and then come back again with a big rush. So it's a hectic kind of involvement, but very exciting. So I think if anyone's interested in that area, I think you'll find it to be very exciting. So graphic design studios is one form, and advertising agencies is another. And I also wanted to show you, this website up, another journal is called Communication Arts, which is kind of the Bible of graphic design. You know, every industry has its publication, and it's a way to network with colleagues in the profession. It's a way to find out what's happening nationwide and even worldwide, and find out about events that are coming up, conferences and other kinds of things, and see what's going on visually. So here, I brought this in. What am I showing here? I think I'm showing, I'm not really sure what I've got up. I think this is an internet website that they've identified that they like, the magazine likes. So these specific websites, yeah, these are websites that they've identified as being notable. And it's a matter of part of what the magazines provide, the professional magazines to the profession, is to show what the magazine deems as being notable and worth looking at, worth talking about. So there are professional journals, and there's many in every profession. This isn't the only one. There's many, many more of this type that identify certain kinds of things that they know the graphic designers, who is the audience, want to look at, want to hear about, want to read about. So those are some of the kind of visual things that we can find about graphic design. If you're interested in that area, it behooves you to kind of search the internet, look at the sites of some of the professions out there, some of the studios, advertising agencies, some of the journals, and begin to acquaint yourself with some of the avenues about what's happening in the profession to learn more about it. Let's see if I have a phone call. Let's see if I can get someone on here, see if I can get my glasses on. Well, this is Cindy calling from Los Angeles. Okay, Cindy, how you doing?
Hi, my name's Cinnamon, though.
Okay.
Yeah, I wanted to make a comment about the advertising. Isn't Obama's campaign posters a symbolism of art and advertising?
Ah, okay. Okay, I understand what you're talking about. Yeah, that's good, that's good. So, Cindy, are you from one of our high schools?
No, I'm from Dominguez, South Lake Dominguez.
Oh, okay, you're right here in Dominguez.
Yeah.
Oh, good, good. All right. So, have you looked at the Morrissey and the Loneliest Monk? Have you looked at that?
Yes, I have.
Okay. And so you're seeing, are you seeing the premise regarding the reaction to the audience thing?
Yeah, it seems, it has a lot of feeling, like emotion to it. That's what I'm getting out of it, or movement.
Okay, I kind of had a hard time picking you up there, but let's see what some other folks have to say about that and see what we can come up with. I appreciate you calling. Thank you very much. All right, again, let me remind you that you can call 800-339-1193, or you can text in, and if you remember, what we're dealing with is the question about David Carson's premise regarding the reaction of the audience to his Ray Gun magazine spread on the article on Morrissey. And this is the image in our text called Morrissey, the Loneliest Monk. Let's put that up and see if we can, in this room, ring some bells for you. This is the image of the layout for the magazine spread. You can see this is the center spread, this the centerfold right here. And so he's dealing with two pages, one page here and one page here. And this is concerning a, if I remember right, so it's a musician. So he had something to say about this. See if you can tell me what this is about so we can find some information about how this particular graphic designer had a reaction to how the audience should react. He kind of had a conclusion about that in his graphic design, what he thought was important, okay? All right, let's continue on here. Let me show you some work that I've done in graphic design. This is just to show you, kind of, I have a little, I can talk a little more personally about this. This is a piece I did for a local businessman. It's called Futures Unlimited Brochure, and this was dealing with a company that was actually a startup company, meaning they're just getting themselves established. It was they wanted to deal with kind of a middleman in coordinating services, medical services, well, basically, I shouldn't say medical services, I'm talking about career services for people looking to find their, and facilitate their careers. And they call it Futures Unlimited. And what they had was a three-step process of going through this plan that they had of working with getting into your career. And this logo I designed was in a way expressing the feeling that someone might have about being all confused about their future, and then through going through the plan of Futures Unlimited, they would be straightened out and on their path, successfully moving forward in the career. So that's where that came from. And then the name Futures Unlimited is here, and then the icon for the plan is here in these steps, kind of saying you take these steps forward by going up a staircase to success. So you see the staging behind the images. There's always a reason for the images in graphic design. This is another one. My son went to this school, St. Francis High School, and I had the opportunity to design a brochure that was sent out to prospective parents who were interested in bringing their son to, this was a boys' school, bringing their son to St. Francis. So this booklet was really designed to communicate information about St. Francis High School. I'm only showing you the cover here, just to, I also designed the interior. But again, the cover was based on the Roman arch, and inside the Roman, which of course is an icon not only of the origins of the Catholic Church, but also of the much of the architecture around Southern California. And of course, the name of the school and up here, and of course, the basic identity of the school, College Preparatory Cappuccino Franciscans. I forget how to pronounce that. God, you probably know better than I do. And then, I also designed the logo I redesigned their logo for the school. I don't think I have that up big, so I don't have it in the small part there. The reason this is brown is because the color of the school colors were brown and yellow, if I remember correctly. So I put that color out here, and then that was used throughout the magazine as well to kind of carry through that theme. Okay, so that's the St. Francis piece. Oh, I have a text here from Philip, and Philip says, Carson's premise was to first try to draw the attention of the viewer to the design to make him or her curious about the article, what the article was about. Now, Philip, you have very good observation. That is very close to what we're after here. Let me just take a look at this. This is... Let me tell you what page that's on, you guys. I wonder if you look it up. You can do that at least, okay? There's some things that he had in mind here, though. Some specific. Philip is in the ballpark here, okay? There's some specific things I'm interested in having you identify in what Carson has to say. But basically, Philip is in the ballpark. So let's see where he goes from that, if anyone else can narrow that down a little bit more, and then we'll... We're going to nail it down a little bit later on, so you'll be sure to know what that is. It might be important to you. When I open up that midterm, it just might be important to you. Okay, let me just continue on here. So those are a couple of brochures that I did. And then, one is a staple bound, the St. Francis staple bound. And the first one you saw is actually a twofold piece. It's actually called a six panel, because it has 3 panels on each side, and it's a letter, folded into a letter fold. Okay, another piece I'll do is advertising, but only advertising in the sense that it's advertising a product. This is it's titled From Our Family Office to Yours, and this is a piece that I did around Thanksgiving. It was a holiday piece, and what I did here was utilize a Rockwell painting of Thanksgiving. And I mimicked the layout of Rockwell with the people in the office of this company, with the couple who own the office at the very head of the table. They actually did cook a turkey, fully cooked turkey there, and we had some bread, and I think there's maybe a couple other things. And then we had to kind of, we took a conference table here and put everyone together and did this shot. And then we used kind of holiday text here. It says, From our family office to yours, happy holidays, the name of the company, and then contact information down here. So it really is a goodwill ad, called a goodwill ad. Meaning that they're not trying to sell a product. They're just saying, hey, we're grateful for the holidays. We're wishing you a happy holiday. That's really all the ad is. You'll see lots of ads of that sort, particularly now that we're going into the holidays. You'll see companies will put out those kinds of ads, a little teeny advertising, but basically it's kind of goodwill. Okay, another piece that I did is for the same company, it's called 3 Generations of Service and Reliability. Here the point was to identify that this is a family organization, and that it started with the grandfather, has moved to the son, and now it's going to be brought down to the children. So 3 generations here. So let's take a look at this full scale here. And I had the opportunity to not only deal with the layout of this, but I also had the opportunity to write the copy on this. And it was a It's not every day that, or not all the time, that graphic designers want to write copy. And then I had these original photographs that were from the family that I put together to identify the family members coming down at an angle here, with the layout being kind of these rectangles that are fitting together. We have these rectangles, and putting this together to make the composition have a fairly solid look. So that's kind of the philosophy behind the piece, so that you know where it's coming from. Again, graphic designer deals with the visual layout, the visual solution to the marketing problem. One of the things I had the opportunity when I was in graduate school to work at Hallmark Cards out in Kansas City, and this is a piece that I did for them. I worked in their packaging department, and I did, this is actually a collaboration. I worked with an artist. They had a big group of artists there, and then a small group of packaging designers, and I was assigned the project to design a series of boxes for greeting cards, and I came up with the idea of a train, and here I show the engine, and I came up with the idea of this kind of carton, and then an artist did the graphics based on the train concept, and I did the type, and a packaging engineer actually designed the package so it would work. I came up with the idea of doing this wrap over here, this curved wrap over. So you see how it's a collaboration. This is one of the things about working in business. You collaborate. You don't sell and work alone. Only the very top-end people work alone, and they usually just deal with a basic idea, and then someone else fills it all in. And you'll find that when you're working as a graphic designer, or filmmaker, or writer, whatever it is, that you work with other people. You have to get along with other people. You have to work with other people, bring their ideas in. It becomes a collaboration. Okay, so that's kind of a synopsis of some of the things that I've done over the years, and give you an idea of some of the work that I've dealt with. So packaging, advertising, brochures, logos. I mean, you end up doing it all. Okay, let's talk about signs and symbols in graphic design. Signs and symbols, really, you know, this is the area of a mark as a form of communication. I mean, we've seen movies where, you know, a Western movie where somebody can't write and they put an X down for their signature. Well, that's kind of the very primitive form of symbols. This is a pictograph. Pictographs are, again, kind of primitive form of dealing with a way to communicate. So we see here, first screen, you see how a head of an ox might be reconfigured in a very abbreviated way to give us this symbol of an ox, okay? And how something like this might be mountainous, I'm not sure what this was referring to, but it might end up, you know, being an M eventually. And that's basically how letters and forms evolve. This is another kind of a typical outline that we're familiar with, the old skull and crossbones. And we know this from a number, to mean a number of things. One, we know it means poison. We see it on medicine. We see it on materials that are indeed poison. That's a symbol that we also see as a symbol of the pirate. We know that the skull and crossbones is a, I don't know if it was actually used as pirates. I think that's kind of grown out of a folklore and this kind of a mass interpretation. I'm not really sure if that's truly what the pirates used or not. But we're all there now that Halloween's coming up. That'll be a favorite image that we'll see out there when the trick-or-treaters knock on the door. Let me show you an interpretation of symbols in a poster, a cultural poster. This was done in Ecuador. And it is basically using this symbol of what we now see as a target. In fact, that's what they're doing with here, as a target. And this is writing down here. Of course, it's in Spanish, and I couldn't understand it anyway, but I can't read it. But basically what I wanted to show you was a symbol of a target and then of a male and female symbols. So that we begin to see that this really is telling us several things. The target is zeroing in on something, and a male and female suggesting that it either deals with both female and male, or somehow male and female together are dealing with this, and having on the same circle suggests that they're somehow joining, maybe they're married, maybe it's just couples, I'm not really sure what it leads to. You can see how it begins to communicate something to us, something more than artwork, perhaps. It's supposed to be more specific meaning, but it can kind of penetrate our subconscious. Okay, let's look at a little piece, six sports symbols. This is a Galician island piece for tourists, and it deals with, as I talked about, Olympic graphics and sporting event graphics. In this case, this is a piece that's suggesting sporting events are activities that we would be able to identify readily through the symbol. I mean, we can see this might be someone diving, this might be someone, falling, so I'm not really sure what that's suggesting. This might be soccer, this might be handball, or perhaps volleyball, basketball, tennis. It's also interesting how we can identify this as men and women. And even the man kind of has a little bit of a pudgy midriff here. So is it older guys, people with a little overweight problem maybe? I'm not really sure what they're suggesting there, but we do have that connotation. So again, you can see how graphic designers will communicate more than perhaps what is just an obvious image. So it's interesting how that works in terms of the graphic designer, but it's really true. As a graphic designer builds up a client, works with a project with a client, they look for this kind of information, asking, what do you want to communicate? What's important about this product or this service? What do we want to say? What needs to be said here? What's important to the audience? Okay, let me show you another one, Channel 2 logo and the Channel 2 mobile. You can see here how a graphic designer dealt with a three-dimensional piece, where here we have the logo, which is kind of a drop shadow in two directions off of the white letter. So a good use of positive and negative space here. And it's a very important element, by the way, for art designers to work with. Then we see the three-dimensional effect, where the two is combined into a vehicle, kind of a van that's been modified. You see the modification on the front of it to maintain that curve. So in this case, it shows how graphic designers get involved with three-dimensional graphics as well as two-dimensional graphics. I mean, you think of three-dimensional graphics as exhibition graphics, graphics that has a signage that has three-dimensional effects to it, displays like this particular piece. When you go into a counter and you see the display of goods that are on where the cashier is, those are called point of purchase displays. Those are done by graphic designers. And some of the package designers get involved with those as well. Okay, another one is three colored logos. I have to find these logos. I wanted to show these to you because this is a big area of graphic design work, and it's very important to companies to have logos. In fact, our book talks about the importance of logos and what it does for companies. And it's a signature in a way. Important that they have this. It's a very light blue. I wish it was on a darker background, but it's very difficult to see because of the light color. It's a beautiful use of the ampersand in two sizes. It's almost hard to know where to start, but you can see it curve around here and come up and curve around to another and come back down and start over again. It's a very graceful, elegant kind of calligraphy kind of image. Here we have three men done with leaves in kind of a propeller-like format where they spiral out from each other. It's just a repeated image in the series of three here. But a very nice image of using this leaf as a format. Here we have one that is on kind of an angle. We see how the letters angle. Even here we have a negative space over here dealing with a film festival. But isn't it interesting they have a baby carriage up here? What are they trying to tell us with that, do you think? I'm not really sure if it's Zagreb is a word in a foreign language that has some connotation with babies and baby carriage or infants. I'm not really sure. But if they want to know, let us know. We can begin to see how the artist has used this image, this combination of typography and image. Very common in logos to have that kind of combination. Let's talk a little bit about typography and layout. First, what's very important, of course, is parts of the letter. And a typographer, a very famous typographer that I met, who works at, he was partially up at, hired up as an instructor up at Art Center School of College, Art Center College, Darrell Young. And this is a page from his book at the, where he identifies the parts of letters. And you look at this, you can see how very complex a letter can be. You look at this full screen here. You can see how he's identified all of these parts. And when we look at a letter that is, we look at typography all the time, and we have all of these various parts. We've got the counter, we've got the serif, we've got the stem, we've got the brackets underneath, we've got the flourish and the tail. It just goes on and on and on and on. There's all kinds of parts here, same sets of anatomy of the body. So it's indicative of how very complex lettering can be. Let's look at a new typeface designed by Matthew Carter. There's thousands and thousands and thousands of different styles and designs of type. And each one, if you might ask, well, why are there so many? Well, but each one has a different expression. Just the color. If you look at colors, and each color can have a different feeling, a different expression. And typography does the same thing. But look at this particular piece. And you see, if you can see this or not, but if you look at a particular letter, if I take the H here, for example, I can see that the stems are not straight. They have a little bow to them. They kind of come down like this. They have a bow to them, and they're a little thicker at the top and the bottom. And the horizontals are straight, and then they have this, I'm exaggerating, of course, but that's one of the characteristics of this typeface. So type has it's soft. It doesn't have a lot of harsh edges to it. And designers are coming with new typefaces all the time. Some there's two basic categories of typefaces. One is called display type. The other is called text type. Display type is the category of like headlines and short phrases, whereas text type is used for big bodies of type, like a book, like a magazine, like a newspaper. Easy to read, comfortable, doesn't make your eyes fatigue. So that's the major difference. Let's look at typography, again, a logo done by Doyle Young for Knapp Communication Corporation. It's their logo. Here you can see how, again, he used very obviously negative and positive space. Look how he opened up this black part to let the white bleed out of there, capture the rest of it. So we get this folding of the what's called the serif. This is the serif down here, how it comes around. We get a feeling of that through the negative space. And then down here, he puts in the, in a very low-keyed kind of typeface, puts in the name of the company. Now, this is a newer poster with a lot of type in it, the Avni T Theater poster done in Europe by Scott Williams and Henry Kubel. And what's interesting about this is how type is combined into a composition. And that's one of the elegant aspects that graphic designers can bring to type. They can make a layout just with lettering be so very beautiful to look at. When we look at this, we see this big T here as a negative positive image, the white type against the black type. And then as we get in here, this kind of leads us in to this area in here where we have to kind of search out the lettering. And then down below is the contact information. So the middle piece, the energy usage in the U.S., the United States, by type of energy. And this is another area that graphic designers can lend a lot of help to, particularly for the viewer, to decipher these graphs I mean, how many of you in school have had to do bar graphs and pie graphs and other kinds of graphs? And it's kind of, you know, mundane, and they don't look very exciting, but they communicate a lot of information. Well, if you can dress those up and do something with them visually, it makes them much more interesting. So here's a bigger piece where a graphic designer has done that in a page layout. You can see how he's made this in kind of a curve, almost like a converging image, almost like a squid, or some kind of, at least I see it, kind of like an underwater thing, but very nice curves. It's all very organized. The information is put in out here so we know what each bar is dealing with. He even gave us a pie graph, kind of an overview at this point, and then giving us the detailed information down here, the text up in here. So a graphic designer brings a lot to this kind of information. Any reports, information, statistics, those kinds of things can be much more palatable to read and be involved in if they're visually easy for us to deal with. Let's look at one last one, this Morrissey, the Loneliest Monk. I wanted to show you that piece and tell you kind of what we had here that he had to say. I just want to read it to you so I can get it verbatim. And it's interesting about this piece because he really had an interesting layout. Notice when you look at this layout, if I can show up full screen for a second, just to point out some things that he's done. First of all, notice how heavy this side is compared to this side. That's one thing. It's out of balance, which is okay. Notice how the Morrissey is very low-keyed here, subordinate. What stands out? This black area. This area here stands out, and then you see this. So it's really emphasizing the text. It's very difficult to read the text. Notice how he cut this in half. The word Morrissey is cut in half. He's bumped it apart here. Even the subheadline here is called the lower part is over here. This is broken up. So he's made it really difficult for us to read this. And he's done that intentionally. That's what's important about this. Here's what he says about this. Person points out that legibility and communication are not the same thing. Legibility and communication, two different things in his mind. Communication begins by attracting and engaging the viewer's attention. So Philip was kind of on the target there when he said that the graphics were the important part. The reader is attracted to the mood of the design, will be willing to make an effort to decipher the message. And you see all this breakup that Carson has put in this piece is intentional. It's intentional to make the viewer work. If you're interested, you'll work for it. It's kind of like the mom and dad attitude toward kids, right? If you want to watch TV or play on the computer, you got to work for it. And do your chores, do your homework, whatever it is. So the same is true here. Carson, he first attracts the viewer through communication, and then legibility, the viewer has to work to read the piece. So that's what this is about. So that's what I wanted to point out to you about David Carson's philosophy on this, as he's demonstrated this particular piece. Okay? All right, good. Well, let's just talk this briefly, and then we're going to have a break here. I want to wrap this up about the word and image. This piece from the Moulin Rouge, done by, what's his name? Henry, I can't think of the little short guy's name. Anyway, you see this piece? This is done in the late 1800s. But what can I think of his name? He's an artist who did these lovely posters. The point here is that this is an early piece of graphic design dealing with, again, graphic using words and using image. And you see what a beautiful image we have here. This dancing girl back here throwing her leg out there. This guy here, the gentleman coming with his cigar. All the people in silhouette back in this part. And then the words identifying what this is about. The Moulin Rouge, the concert hall, La Gouache, is that what that is? I'm not really sure how you pronounce that. But the point is that the graphic designer deal with text and they deal with images. Let's look at one more piece, the poster Ashton Ragat,
McDonagh culture. I think that's how it's pronounced. I think this is a Scottish piece out of East Europe. And what's interesting about this is that it has some of the attributes of what was called constructivism in the that really emerged out of Slavic countries, particularly Russia. And it has this kind of revolutionary kind of feeling to it. With the guys all lined up here, and a young lady, looks like, holding the flags, proclaiming something, some statement. And then down below, we have the statements again in red. Red is very strong, young, youthful, healthy-looking, soldier-like people. So it has this structure. Easy, Philip, give Philip his gold star. We got a, I don't know who I was thinking of when I was saying Henry, but Philip, yeah, terrific trip. Thank you, Philip. Appreciate that. He's the one who did all the posters for the Moulin Rouge. He hung out the Moulin Rouge, so hang out the Moulin Rouge. That'd be quite fun. Okay. One more piece that you're familiar with, the iPod silhouette. Again, figure and words. Figure and words. We see three different separations here of the use of figure and words. Notice this. Minimized words, iPod, identity down here, and then this lovely silhouette image of a young woman with her iPod. Notice how this is done in white. Notice how they did that in white, which merges with the words. Merges with the words. Very clever. Very simple, but very powerful. Very powerful. And Lynette says, I'm going to wrap this up, then we'll take a break. What Lynette says, he says, graphic design and commercialism are so intertwined. How do artists get artistic and creative freedom and still succeed? That's a good point, Lynette, because graphic designers, most graphic designers, like myself, came out of a beginning of interest and involvement in producing art. I did in high school, I did drawings and things, and I did stuff for the theater, and I did my own drawings, so that's kind of where I came from. And I think what you'll find, that's what I found, is that graphic designers, they have two worlds they live in. One is the commercial world, the professional world, where they do the graphic design. They have a client, they have limitations, they have constraints, they have deadlines, they have budget. That's a file. They have people they got to work with, very regimented, and they do their job, and then they go home, and they change clothes, and they have whatever they need to relax, and they go into their studio or wherever, and they take out their paints, they may do sculpture, they may do printmaking. I know a guy who did prints. I do ink line drawings myself. I think I showed you some. And different people do different things. I know a guy who taught for us here who painted. He loved to paint. He went up through the ranks of the till in graphic design, became one of their, he oversaw the design and the operation of the Barbie dolls for many years. And yet he was basically an artist. He always wanted to paint. That was his love. And ended up in graphic design. So that's a good point. It's always a merging of those two worlds. Okay, we're going to take a break. We're going to come back, and we're going to continue with chapter 11, I think it is, dealing with sculpture. So don't go there.
You are watching VHTV, television program service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Hi, I'm Kathy Zimmer-Erd, Director of the University Art Gallery at California State University, Dominguez Hills. We are looking forward to an exciting slate of exhibitions and invite you to attend our exhibitions and events.
The 50th Anniversary Alumni Art and Design Exhibition. It will feature 75 works of art in varied media by 30 art and design of department alumni. Highlighting the alumni exhibit will be Jeff Guerrero's glowing ceramic plates and brilliant oil pastels, Matt Jackson's intricate silk screen prints, Janice Lloyd Gobert's fragile ceramic seed pods, H.K. Zamani's vigorous abstractions, and Susan Venable's delicate bronze rectangular sculpture, Joe Edward Grant's luminous paintings of houses, and Eric Miles' strong mixed-media drawings, and collages of monumental African-American figures.
Please join us at the University Art Gallery at California State University, Dominguez Hills. We look forward to seeing you at our exhibitions and events.
California State University, Dominguez Hills Department of Theater and Dance have made it easier than ever to attend a performance on campus. You can now go online, buy a ticket, and choose your seat all with the click of your mouse. Just go to tickets.csudh.edu, click on Buy Your Ticket, choose your seat, and you'll be on your way to the theater.
I'm Tiffany from Cal State Dominguez Hills Athletics Department, and welcome to the Toros Coaches Corner. This edition, we have the head women's volleyball coach with us, Scott Davenport. Welcome, Coach.
Thanks, Tiff.
All right. Although the team didn't finish as well as hoped, it played probably in the toughest league in America, the CCAA. Tell us what the team learned from that experience and what we can look forward to this year.
Well, I think they learned a lot about preparation. You know, we've been kind of trying to impart them certain behavior and how they have to model to improve, you know, each week in and out. But preparation is a big thing.
That core that you're referring to, returning players, is this the year that we challenge the elite teams in the conference with those returners?
Being an optimist, I'd like to say yes. I think the core of returning players, they know what we expect of them. They know what we expect them to teach and lead the incoming players.
Now, what can people expect to see when they come out to watch the Toros this season?
Well, we're going to kind of focus on tenacious defense. That's kind of what we're going to be known for. We're going to go after our serves. We're going to try to keep every ball alive. We're going to run a very fast offense, too. So, a lot of speed, a lot of energy. Just expect what you can see.
Well, Coach, I'm sure I speak for many when I say I can't wait to see you guys this season in action. And I just want to thank you for joining us on this edition of the Toros Coaches Corner. And until we see you in the stands, remember to make every day your masterpiece. Go Toros.
Hi, my name is Monique Higliel. I'm currently attending California State University Dominguez Hills from West Los Angeles College. I chose Dominguez Hills because I heard about the great facility and the great people.
Hello everyone, welcome back to Art 100, Looking at Art. I'm Bernard Baker, Professor of Art, California State University, Dominguez Hills. And we're talking about sculpture now. We're in Chapter 11 and dealing with sculpture. And I'm sure all of you are familiar with sculpture in one form or another. We have a lot of sculptural pieces here in Los Angeles, outdoor sculpture. And I'm sure that some of you have seen sculpture in your own schools. Might be what we call bust headpieces,
of some dignitary or some important person. And so we're all familiar with sculpture of some form. But there's some specifics we need to know. Let me just ask you this one question and show you a couple of examples here. See if you can identify something for you. Kind of an important term, because it's generic to a particular category of sculpture and certainly something we see in sculpture occasionally. The question is, which figure, I'm going to show you here, which figure demonstrates contrapposto? And what is contrapposto? So let's look at two images here. One is the Virgin and Child and the Crescent Moon. You see this picture? I'll show that up full screen. We have here the Child here, and we have the Virgin here. And the Crescent Moon is actually down here someplace. I can't see what the detail is down there. So that's one. Let me show you the next one. This is colloquially called the Scraper. It's a Apotheomentos, a Greek piece. And we have this typical of Greek, nude young male in very naturalistic, that is idealized human male with this arm here that would be a tool that is goes around here to scrape the sweat off as an athlete and standing up here. So which one of these demonstrates contrapposto? Which one of these, and what is contrapposto? So that's your question. See if you can let me know what that is, and that'll help us out a lot. You can call 800-339-1193, or you can text in, which is what most of you do, okay? Okay, let's go on to the methods of sculpture. There are four methods of sculpture that our author tells us about. Modeling, casting, carving, and assembly. Modeling and assembly are what's called, they're in the category of additive sculpture, meaning you add things on to make the sculpture, basically. And carving is subtractive. In other words, you cut away. We would have a block, and we would carve away from it. So that's the two categories. Additive and subtractive. So additive, we have modeling and assembly, and subtractive, we have carving. Now, one category where that does not fit in either one is casting. We'll talk about that in just a little bit. It doesn't really fit either one. So that gives us our four types, our methods of sculpture: modeling, assembly, carving, and casting, and how they fit into the two categories. Okay? So modeling, let's talk about modeling. Modeling is shaping a form in some plastic material or common media, are clothes, fluffy, silly putty, a Play-Doh, I'm sure you have a Play-Doh. Fluffy, rolls of air stocked in the I know that your hands are all messed up, I know, but hey, this is the fun part. So, we can make something out of clay, and we can do modeling, okay, which is ending. So, we will start with, break off some here. I will start with some kind of form, and then I will start adding to it. Now, it turns out that, I mean, I remember taking basic sculpture when I was in school, and you add and you subtract, it turns out. You do both. Because, you know, you add things on, and then pretty soon you've added too much, and you start subtracting it off. So, basically, you know, you end up doing both. But it fundamentally is an add-on kind of process. So, as I'm dealing with this piece, I would begin to add on my sculpture, add on more clay to it in order to build the kind of image that I want to build here, and have a form. You can see something emerging now. I can see something emerging. I'm kind of like a Michelangelo. You should see a form, and then out of that would come an image. is I'm kind of molding this all together here. You see his torso? You see a torso here? I'm going to build up the head here. See this guy? You see that? See that? I get behind it, it makes it dark. Okay. And then I would say these are arms, these are incomplete arms. In other words, I just have the upper arm coming out, kind of like it's been cut off. And then I would come in and I start to maybe build more around the brow up here. Start to form that. Start to build the nose here. See how it begins to form. And then I put some eyes in here. Then also I can see it. A chin on this guy. He doesn't have a chin. Where's the girl? Here's the girl. You see that? You see that starting to form? Okay, shape, I turn. Maybe I want to turn the head a little bit. Maybe he's looking up at something. That's modeling. Okay, so I'm modeling here. I'm modeling an image, and I would continue to build it, refine it, smooth whatever I want to do to make it into the kind of form that I want. So that's modeling. And it's very fun to do. It's very relaxing. It's a lot of you enjoy it. You gotta enjoy it. So maybe you would. I don't know if you tried this or not. This is something that I'm hoping that this class will encourage some of you to get involved in the arts in one form or another, and begin to have this kind of an activity. You might find it something you really enjoy doing, and you'd be very good at it too. Okay, so that's modeling. So I wanted to make sure you understand that. Now you can do that in other materials besides clay. I mean, obviously, any kind of more malleable material can do it. I remember as a kid doing it in mud, making dinosaurs and things in mud. I remember that so vividly. I didn't think about that so just now. Okay, let's talk about casting. I'm kind of going out of the sequence here, but I just wanted to talk to you about casting a little bit here. Because casting is something that is kind of misunderstood. And our book really deals with a very elaborate process of casting. It goes with a schematic that shows these eight steps of casting, seven steps basically. It starts out with, like, show this full screen here, I'll show you what I mean. It starts out with a core. It starts out with something that's called a master, but it starts out with a sculpted piece. This may be on a clay, plaster, any number of things. Could be a wooden piece, a metal piece. And then it is coated with some kind of material to make it release. A wax. This will also be wax. I think it's showing the lost wax process. So this will probably be wax. Although I'm going to show you an example where it's not wax. This would be wax, refined, and it's put into it has spews coming, what's called spews coming off. Wax, it's got a wax core down here. And what goes before is to allow, it's actually going to be turned upside down. Molten metal will be put in here, and it will burn out all this wax and fill in all the voids. This image is actually hollow. So this is actually a wax hollow image of this master. Okay. And then this wax image with its spews are put in casting material. Like, it's like a plaster of Paris. And then it is submerged here. What are they doing here? It's kind of hard for me to read this, but just make sure I get this right so that I don't get you confused. And the process differs depending upon
who's dealing with it in regard to the process. So I want to make sure that I don't get you confused on this, because there's several different ways this can be done, and it's just a matter of how they want to start or test this piece concerning the outcome. I know when I was in jewelry, we did this the same kind of process as a very simple what they call a lost wax process. And this particular process that they're describing here, they're putting in they put it in a oven and they melt out the wax. And then they now have this all hollow in here where the wax was, but it's inside this plaster. They pour in the molten material. It goes into all of those voids and fills and makes the image, whatever it is, the art image. And then it's left to cool, and the next thing they do is to break off all this casting plaster around the image. And it's going to come out, it's going to have all these spews on it. Those have to be cut off. So those are cut off, and then the piece is ground down nice and smooth and refined to be the finished piece. So that's how it's being explained in our text. And that's, you can see it's a very laborious process, and it takes a lot of time to get that all done. Now, let me show you a piece I picked up today when I was over here. I went into the sculpture studio, and the class was in there. And they've been doing castings, and they do it a very simple way. They make a master out of, usually out of clay, it could be out of wax, and they then put it into, here's an image, I mean, you see this, I'm not sure if you need to overhead or not, but this is two hands, this energy, two hands, and then we have the locking devices here. Two baby hands, this is probably done with they might have just actually used a doll and just pressed in here to make the images. On both sides, you notice the hands are on both sides of this. You can see, I don't know if you can see that or not, but it's an image that's basically cut in half. And then you see that on both sides. And then these parts here, these little half balls, and this is the negative part of that, are simply locating and locking devices. And this is put together like this, and then plaster is poured in here, and or whatever material they want. They usually use plaster because they can't afford anything very expensive. And then once it's hardened, this is opened up, and the piece is taken out. Now, if they want the piece to be hollow, many times what they'll do is they'll just pour in a little bit around the edges, rotate this, make the plaster get around the edges, and that way they can get a semblance of a hollow piece, not have a solid piece. So it's not simple casting. They have to put a release agent on this. They may put on some kind of commercial release agent so the object will break loose. Or they may put on, we used to use liquid soap. I think some other materials that are commonly available that can be used as a release agent. So that's how casting is done in a very simple manner. The hard part, of course, is making the coming up with the original image, and then they cast this plaster. They just make a wooden frame and cast it in a wooden box, and then let that harden up, and that's it. So it's pretty straightforward how casting is done. Okay, so that's casting. It's an indirect process. You know how we talked about printmaking as an indirect process, where the original artwork is not the finished artwork, it's the pieces that are cast. Those become the finished pieces. So when you go into souvenir shops, or you go into a gallery and you see a cast piece, it can be one of a kind. Sometimes an artist will just cast one piece, or it could be a more commercial venture where an artist actually has a number of castings done, just like we would in printmaking, from a particular master. And then they break the mold so no more can be made from that piece. So it's a limited edition again. Okay. Common materials in casting are bronze, plaster, plastic, clay, and then
art of precious metals, and if we get into jewelry and silver making, which we'll see later on, the same process is used in those areas as well. And Anissa says, as she texts in, she says, the scraper, Apostle Mentos, shows Tantra Prasno. Do you think so, Anissa? Oh, so someone else says. Tantra Prasno, she says, is the technique where the body of the sculpture is placed in a gentle S-shaped curve. S-shaped curve. Like this? S-shaped curve? What does she mean by that, I wonder? Okay. She might be onto something here, though. Let's see what somebody else has to say about this. Do you really think the scraper or Apostle Mentos is the one that shows contrapposto? And is it defined as a gentle S-shaped curve? Well, let's see. See if someone else can text in and verify or counter what Anissa has to say. Okay? All right, let's go on and talk about, let's see some examples of casting. Let's look at the equestrian monument of Colleoni. I don't think he's related to the Colleoni family from The Godfather. I don't think so. But here we see this wonderful piece, a very common kind of sculpture that was done particularly in Europe, but also common in today, not necessarily with a horse, but with a soldier or some dignitary, where all of this, and this could be a larger-than-life image, is cast. And this is a very complex cast, not just something in half. They may have to do many pieces. They may have half of it up here, both sides. They may have, like here, where he's turned. They may have to have it, you know, like three pieces, or who knows how many pieces. But also, they may cast this in parts. They may cast the hindquarters of the horse, the front of the horse, the soldier, and then weld it all together. So there are different ways that this can be put, the process can be brought together. Let's look at one more called the head of the Achaemenid ruler, done in 2300 BCE. Beautiful piece, very symmetrical as we see it face on. But it's a cast piece, do I see where it's cast? I think this is bronze, if I remember correctly. Look at all the detail, all the texture that was captured in this piece. But whether this was done as lost wax, I'm sure it was, some sort of lost wax process. So you can see that it's not a new process at all. Now this piece has been broken out here in the eye, probably with precious metals or precious jewelry or something up in that area. But again, this process goes back a long ways. It's used throughout the world, and it's one that's proven itself over and over again. Okay, so that's casting. Let's talk about carving. Sculpture begins with a block of material. And cuts, chips, gouges away until the form of the sculpture emerges. We'll see later on when we talk about the Renaissance, the great sculptors. Well, even before that, there were great sculptors, but one that I've always admired, of course, is Michelangelo. We'll see a piece of his here in a second. One piece I brought in, though, that's a wooden carved piece is this woman that was carved out of redwood. Just to show you how the redwood was put together as two metaphors and glued together. Can you see that? Glued together to make this big block, and then the servant took this block. You see how those are just blocks of wood. They may be 2x6s now that I look at them. And glued together, bound, and then carved. With carving tools. The carving tools are just like a chisel, it could be, but they usually are curved, so we get the gouge. If you look at the carving on this, you can see, particularly on the dress, like I showed you on this side, you can see how it's gouged out in almost like a finger shape, like the ball of your finger keeps right in there, so that it's indicative of the round tool. So you can see the detail that can be obtain the expression, and it's a subtractive process. The material is taken away. You can make a mistake, and hard to fix. So that's carving, example of carving. And some of the examples that I have here is a bowl with figures. This is a Olowi piece, an African piece. Beautiful work comes from Africa and other countries, where carving is a common sculptural method, but look at the detail in here. Look how they went into the negative space. And this would have been one big block and he carved all of this out with all the it always amazes me the negative space that they could obtain in these pieces. And then the detail, all the little texture that's on this piece, just beautiful, beautiful texture, expressions on the figures, very complex piece. One more piece by Michelangelo, the Pietà. This is Jesus after the crucifixion and his mother, of course. A beautiful piece, smooth, beautiful shapes, and Michelangelo was beyond a master. He was in the realm of a religious icon of sculpture, in my opinion, just incredible. There's others, Bernini and others who did great sculptures. Well, we'll see about that. Okay, so those are a couple of examples of wonderful stuff from one in wood and one in model. And Philip says, talking about our question of the day, what is contrapposto? He says, I agree. Contrapposto is based on color balance. So when one side is up, the other side is down, right? In the S-shaped pattern. Okay. You also agree, Philip, which of our images is contrapposto? We'll show those one more time. Let's go back and show what did we have here. We had Vincent and Child on the crescent moon. And there she is, center stage. Does she show contrapposto? Does the baby show contrapposto? No, okay, this is the other one. Sometimes we have the scraper. It's called Apotheomontos, and it shows a Greek youth with scraping tools, scraping off the sweat from being athletically active. So which one is showing contrapposto? You didn't answer that part. You're agreeing that contrapposto is based on counterbalance, basically having the S-shaped pattern. So let's see if someone can verify this. Oh, we need one more. We're almost done here. See if you can do this for me as we come to a close here. Okay. Where am I? A carving. High relief. This is the area of where carving and sculpture really deals on a flat plane. Usually they're hung or they may be part of another architectural structure, in this case a door. This is a piece called The Story of Jacob and Esau by Lorenzo Ghiberti, done in 1435. This had to do with a bronze door for which a competition was held to identify the artist to put on these scenes from the Bible in high relief. High relief means it's very deep. Whereas low relief is kind of what we see on our coins, the nickel and the quarter. Those are low relief images. High relief has very deep images. Look at this full screen, and you can appreciate high relief. Or we can actually see shadow, where the images are deep enough that they cast a shadow and take on oxidation. But the images almost they project very deeply off of the scene. They're also big enough to be able to get a lot of detail. You can see the detail in the carving, very much a characteristic of the Renaissance with the kind of garments they're wearing. But a biblical scene, which is a typical scene of that era. Low relief, done in bronze, and carved out. Actually, it's a cast piece, but it's done in another media than cast. I think these are done that way. All right. So that's how we eat. Now let's talk about assembling or assemblage. This is where individual pieces, segments, or objects are brought together to form a sculpture. And this is, let me show you a couple of pieces that I want to do a real quick one for you here. Origins by Mark de Cervero. This is a piece that's using these I-beams that are welded together into this configuration, almost like an X-like shape, with the center piece coming up, these round shapes on the top up here, to give us this huge piece in bread with silver. Almost looks like, it almost looks like, what do you call those, mountain goat horns up there. Anyway, that's assembly. One more piece by Alice Alcock, Waterworks. This is a woman who does these almost architectural pieces, huge pieces, where in this case, this is out in the water here, but it's a big piece that has a spiral-like quality to it, these big curved shapes that are coming up and gracefully going around. This like flower image here, big metal piece. It's a big piece. It's a big center transparent globe out in the middle. So how's this done? Well, very simple way you can do this. Give yourself a base of some sort. It can be wood or it can be something else. I just have a bunch of junk stuff here. I opened that up. And I got a hot glue gun. So I'm going to start out with something. Let me just take something I can get down here pretty quick. Is that marker any good? Not really. And maybe I'll glue this down. So I just put that down there like that. And then maybe I'll come in and I'll start to get myself a flat surface here. Glue this down. I'll have to hold that for a second or two. Let that set up. Oh, that's setting up. See what else I've got here. Put it down there. All kinds of stuff in here. Stuff. Here's some bark off of a tree. I'm going to put this over here. I see something growing here all of a sudden. That's setting up. Then I have to hold this while it sets. While that's doing that, I'm going to do some other things. See if I can get this thing up here somehow. So right now, I'm trying to decide where to put it. Oops, that's not going to set me. This is hot glue, about a minute or so to heat up, to cool off after it's been heated up. And if this is something I can put down, that'll stay. Another piece that is kind of organic piece here. Remember how we talked about organic and geometric shapes? It's something I'm dealing with here, organic and geometric shapes. So as I work with these, I'd be putting together an assemblage. So that's basically what I'm doing, okay? Putting together an assemblage. Now, I've only got 1 minute to go here, so just let me wrap up here and tell you that the thing you're dealing with also in sculpture, make sure you take a look at the earthworks, the pieces that deal with time and place, the earthworks, the site-specific pieces. There are some pieces that are installed that are meant to be like outside the spiral jetty. Then we have temporary specific installations that go up only for a short period of time. One particular piece you want to look at is the Red Room by Louise Bourgeois and the Gate by Gusto. So take a look at those and make sure you have those in mind. Remember, the midterm starts after class, so be ready for it. If you have any concerns, let me know, everyone. Have a good Halloween. Take those trick-or-treats, everyone, and keep looking at art. See you next week, everybody. I'm